And how much of a game changer do you think it is that algorithms on YouTube and on other social media are always pushing you in the direction of the more extreme version of whatever you're consuming? Like, it's a, you know, on the one hand you could say, well, the medium changes, but in the end it's just radicalization has always operated that way, and it's actually or you could say, no, you know, the fact that this technology changes has really made a difference. So what's your view of that?
Well, I think that the world of social media has certainly changed the way that people consume information. To make it simplistic, I think we just need to look at Facebook, for example, the largest platform that we have been confronted with over, you know, the last decade and a half. It's grown to the point where almost everybody in the world has at least used it. Facebook published an internal report from 2016 that documented that 64% of the people that joined an extremist group on their platform did so because their AI recommended it to them. And so what they said was, oh, well, we're creating echo chambers. And so they tried to do the right thing, so to say, and they tried to adjust the algorithm so that it would cross-pollinate between hyperpolarized echoes, getting you out of that sort of echo chamber. The problem was that the users started to spend less time on the platform because of negativity bias, because of whatever reason. And so in the end, Facebook readjusted its AI algorithm so that it returned back to the original state, right? Because they, number one, are profit driven, right? And so this is something where when we think about, and that was back 2016, since that time, what they've done is they've lifted this away from the public realm of knowledge. And they've been sort of, as we've gone more and more cancel culture, especially with regard to the way that ISIS used social media, it created more public pressure to take down content and to do more with the AI to remove violent or radical material. But since that time, we've gotten to a level where the algorithms stay the same, but you create these fraudulent sort of subsidiary efforts to, like, let's assume that people are radicalizing on Facebook and keyword searching for the Proud Boys, which there's no empirical evidence to suggest that's the case. And it doesn't actually happen that way. And then they link you to a commercial, an advertisement. People are asked to click on the ad. And you look at the data and the success rates, it does absolutely nothing. But then they can turn your face in the other direction and try to make it look like they're doing something, right? And at this point, what we have is we have the complication of that, especially because if you look at the rates of content that is now being removed over a long term, especially post-Capitol riots, now the number of Facebook hate posts on all of the major platforms that are being removed each month have gone up exponentially. So the content is reducing. But what we're not thinking about now on the other end of things, because this is public pressure, they're not going to use the platform if indeed Facebook doesn't adjust to this sort of mob mentality, cancel culture mentality. But what we're doing is we're pushing people psychologically into echo chambers where we might reduce the number of people that have access to radical messages, but those that are already radicalized are coming to the conclusion that they're being censored, and then they're actually engaging only with each other. And that will solidify radicalization, the us versus them perspective, the dehumanization of the other. They will feel like they are victims, and a higher propensity of those will go on to become terrorists or violent extremists. And we experienced this under ISIS, even though we didn't realize it. Now, it's a much broader conversation about what constitutes violent extremist speech versus hate speech. But essentially what you have in the social media companies is they are beholden to profit. And if the public says, we're not going to use your platform and we might get a mass migration, or if they're worried about, you know, Section 230 being repealed so that they have to do more and they're regulated by the government, then they have to move in a direction that facilitates their profit. But their movements are always actually conducive to radicalization, rather than actually able to address the concerns that underlie it.
So, yeah, let's talk about censorship a little bit, because censorship is one of the main tools that, you know, policymakers and social media platforms have in order to fight extremism. You know, when the public complains that such and such a terrorist was radicalized through YouTube, the natural response by YouTube is to ban them, you know, to ban Alex Jones, say. And there are I guess there are two separate criticisms of this move. One is that it is always open to the charge of hypocrisy. You know, Twitter banning Trump, but allowing the spokesperson of the Taliban to still have an account. You know, there's just a million. It would be almost impossible in practice, even if you had a hypocrisy czar, for them to be accurate enough to really satisfy people. So it's sort of a perpetual problem. But then there's this separate criticism that it actually doesn't work in the final analysis. You highlight a trade-off here that is really interesting. It's a trade-off between how many people are exposed to some propaganda and the level of marginalization faced by people already exposed.
Mm-hmm. And that's only in the short term. So we don't know what will be the case in the long term. So in the short term, it appears deplatforming reduces quantitatively the number of people that have access to a radical message. But qualitatively, it might enhance the number of people that are already radicalized that go on to become violent. But in the recent period, post-Capitol riots, post-banning of Trump, we see massive support. And the mainstream narrative, particularly amongst conservatives, is that big tech is censoring conservatives. And they're not wrong. There is a bias that is definitely there. That can be shown in the data. And it is a fact. The situation now becomes people don't. So the scholarly work on this concentrates on one platform, most of it. But anything that concentrates on the internet and social media as an ecosystem shows that extremists just go somewhere else. And so you can ban QAnon and they'll go establish themselves on Telegram, but then they'll craftily adopt new hashtags to go back on Facebook anyway. And they have a firm, committed conspiracy theory and victim narrative that they can espouse over there. This is what we used to do. When they first started to take us down, we kept our content on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter relatively benign, but it always linked to our website where you could get the real stuff. So now the extremists, they migrate to Telegram, they migrate to Signal, they migrate to these other platforms, and Facebook and other companies say, we reduced activity on our platform by 2 million violent extremist posts last month, as if it's an applause. But in actuality, they just kicked it somewhere else, right? And then like something like Parler, which came about in the aftermath of the banning of Donald Trump and in the run-up to the January 6th riots, starts to get traction and has 13 million, some say as many as 32 million people. That poses that sort of Matthew effect preferential attachment beginning where you could have a competitor. But really what they're forcing is a hyperpolarization of the social media landscape in the long run. So we might be, if radicalization does not occur online, and it doesn't, there's no evidence that it does. We're working on a scholarly report with minds.com to adopt a mechanism and a platform and an approach to doing this that does not ban hate speech simply because it makes the problem worse and that thinks creatively about how to do this properly. And it is full of conundrums, but they know everything they do kicks it to other spaces. And it doesn't prevent them from coming back on their platform because you can easily game an algorithm. You just have to learn what gets you removed and what doesn't. And until they tweak it, you're good to go. So this is really the problem is that yes, in the short term, it might appear like deplatforming works. In the long term, you're inducing hyperpolarization of the social media landscape. You're increasing toxic polarization, reciprocal dehumanization, and people feeling like they're victims is definitely a step towards radicalizing to the degree where you say my only recourse is violence.